Hello. So we have begun. We have written our first lines of code. You've hopefully written your first, created your first processing sketches now. You're running stuff. You have stuff drawing to the screen. We've begun. We're on our way. But truth be told, we are missing a massive, a humongous conceptual piece to this puzzle of learning about writing software, about programming the computer that we really need to tackle right now. So this video and the next video, we're going to tackle something. We're going to think about, we're going to call this the flow of a program. The flow of a program. So let's look at this, let's consider this idea of flow in the context of what we have so far. So over here, we have a very simple processing sketch. It's what we've kind of started with. We have size of the window, we draw a background, and we draw a rectangle on the screen. If I run it, you can see this is the result. What's the flow of this program? Well, we can count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 lines of code. It executes each one of those in order, and when it gets to the end, it's done, and voila, rectangle on the screen. But truth be told, I don't know why I walked over here, but I like the white background. Truth be told, that is not how most programs operate. Programs operate in a lot of different ways. You can think of something as event-driven. For example, if you're sitting there using Photoshop, every time you click something or pull down a menu item, some event is triggered, some code is executed, and an image is processed. You can also think of a program as kind of running forever in this loop. If you're playing a game, and if you're playing a game or watching some procedural animation, it's happening over time. Draw the stuff to the screen, move the stuff. Draw the stuff to the screen, move the stuff. That's what Pong is doing. Move the mouse, draw the paddle over here. Move the mouse, draw the paddle over here. You know, programs run over time. They keep track of data over time. They take different paths based on what the user does or what inputs are coming to the program. We need a foundation for writing programs, writing processing sketches that happen over time. Whether that means they run in a loop over and over again, or based on some event that happens, something in the program gets triggered. We're going to look at both of these scenarios. But we're going to start, I think I'm talking about the right thing that I meant to in this video. We're going to start with actually just this idea of an animation loop. And you can think of this again if you were someday I will come up with a better scenario than just starting with thinking of a game, but if you were making a game, Pong, Space Invaders, something more modern, I guess. You would write a program that runs over time. It draws the stuff, it moves the stuff, it draws the stuff. I said that already. Okay, so how are we going to do this? If we come back and look at the sketch, what do we need to add to this sketch so that it runs over time? This program really just executed, finished. We want it to draw over and over and over again so that we can start to animate stuff. So in order to do this, we need to introduce a new concept. This new concept is going to be known as a block of code. I will just write that over here. Block of code. We're going to use blocks of code all the time. When we want to sort of like segment this part of our code does this, this part of our code does this, this is the definition of this, this is the definition of that, we need to create a block of code. A block of code is always noted with an open curly bracket to begin, and a closed curly bracket to end. And then the code that is contained within that block goes in between those curly brackets. So we need two blocks of code. Let's think about this. The flow of our program is actually going to be very, very simple. We're going to have two elements. One we're going to call setup, and one we're going to call draw. I don't know what I'm drawing over here. This is going to be setup, and this is going to be draw. We need some lines of code in setup. We need some lines of code in draw. I need a bigger whiteboard. But anyway, what can you do? Okay, so why do we have these two blocks of code? Here is the flow of a program that we are going to begin with. Our program is going to do some things at the beginning. We're going to think of this as the setup, the initialization conditions. And then it's going to do some things over and over again. And so setup is stuff that's going to happen once and only once. Once and only once. Draw is the stuff, awkwardly, I could like hide back here, that's going to happen forever. Over and over again in a loop. So when it gets to the end, it comes right back up and executes that code again. Code that happens once, code that happens over and over again. Why does this flow make sense for us? This flow makes sense for us. Let's just take, for example, the game Pong again, because there are often a bunch of things you want to do to initialize a program. Pong begins. Set the score to zero. Set the level to zero. Place the paddles in their starting location. Place the puck in its starting location. Then, that's the stuff that happens when you initialize the program. Then, as the program runs over and over and over again, looping and looping, it does stuff like move the paddle, draw the paddle, move the paddle, draw the paddle. If the puck hits the paddle, turn the puck around. If the puck goes past the paddle, increase the score, that type of thing. So all that stuff is always happening while that program is running. When does the program stop? I don't know. In this case, absolutely never. You know, when the computer breaks, when the user hits quit, turns it off, hits quit. Obviously, we could create all sorts of different types of scenarios where a program stops, restarts, all sorts of things. But this is our basic foundation. Some stuff that happens at the beginning and some stuff that happens forever and ever. So let's go back and look at this code for a second and say, okay, here are some things in this program. There's the size function, there's the background function, and there's the other stuff that draws a rectangle. What should happen at the beginning and what should happen forever in a loop? So we can look at this, we can ask that question. You can pause the video right now and then try to answer it for yourself. And then, now you've unpaused it, or you probably didn't do that because who knows why, but anyway, maybe you did. Thank you for, like, humoring me. But I think at least there's one thing that's incredibly obvious, which is that size should go at the beginning. Size is an initialization condition. We're setting up the size of our window. Now, of course, you could probably come up with some scenario where you want the window to dynamically resize while the program is running, but that's not what we're doing right now. What we're doing right now is we're saying, size is something that we have to add, that we have to do once and only once. Now, in an animation program, presumably, we want to draw our stuff over and over again. We always want to draw it in the window. So I'm going to say that our rectangle method, which I forget what the numbers are, but I'll just make some up, is going to go in draw. And the fill and the stroke and all that stuff for drawing the rectangle, we want to draw that stuff forever and ever. Looping over and over again. Set up the initial conditions, draw the stuff over and over again. So there was one more thing over here, background. I forgot to start the timer, I don't know how long I'm going. Background, where does that go? Okay, I'm going to say there's no correct answer to this question. And for now, I'm actually just going to put background here. And we're going to examine this later. What happens if we put background in setup? What happens if we put other? There really are no right answers to these questions. It has to do with what you're creating. This is just the foundation. You have stuff in setup that happens at the beginning and stuff that happens in draw over and over again. How many times can I say that in one video? Probably I've done it too many already. Okay, so this we've now established as what we want to do. We want to have these blocks of code, right? A block of code that is our setup, a block of code that is our draw. But the truth of the matter is the syntax for how we're going to write this is going to suddenly look a little odd. So this is conceptually, I think I've established conceptually what we've got. We've got setup, which has size, in a block of code. We've got draw, which has background and rectangle, in a block of code. But what do we actually have to write in processing? So I'm going to erase everything around this. And I'm going to look at what the actual processing syntax for establishing setup and draw is. And what it is we say void setup, parentheses, open bracket, close bracket. Void draw, parentheses, open bracket, close bracket. So what we should recognize, at least, from this discussion of a block of code is these open bracket, close bracket. This is saying everything in between these two brackets is the stuff that goes in draw. Everything in between these two brackets is the stuff that goes in size. We now no longer want any code anywhere else. Any stray code just somewhere outside of these two blocks would not make any sense. Code only happens in setup and draw. Of course, there are going to be more functions and lots more stuff later, but for now, we can sort of think of it in this simple way. Code only happens either at the beginning or over and over again in a loop. So looking at this, we can understand now, aha, setup, this is the setup block of code, this is the draw block of code, but there's other syntax here that we don't understand, like, this seems so sad, like, why do we have this word void here? I mean, is my programming life void of meaning and happiness, and why is that word there, and there's these parentheses there, and I don't understand that, and what does all this mean? What does any of this mean? The truth of the matter is, this will, what the word void means will come later. Why we have these parentheses here will come later. But one thing we can sort of see about this is what I will mention is what we're actually doing is not, this is a block of code in that it's contained between curly brackets, but what we're actually doing is defining our own function. We're defining the setup function. We're defining the draw function. Those functions are executed by processing automatically, setup at the beginning, draw over and over again. And we've now defined what code should be inside those functions. This will become more clear in video once I figure out what number that is. when I do a video that's all about writing function, more about the sort of syntax of defining functions. But for now, we just need to kind of memorize this syntax. And so let's go over to our processing sketch. Walk over here, and let's add this in. So I'm going to add in, I'm going to say void setup, curly bracket, void draw, curly bracket, and I'm going to obnoxiously remove my comments here just for a second. Oh, I did something. Ah! Help! Everybody stop! Okay, what so I did something that's like a force of like unbelievable habit and nature. I hit Command T, which I didn't want to do because I wanted to at least demonstrate before I did that the way my code looked was like this. So one convention, again, remember, line breaks have no meaning in the way the code executes. The curly brackets define the beginning and end of a block, the semicolon defines the end of a line, but human beings, especially if you're a human being like me, like to keep things incredibly orderly and very nice and neat and to feel comfortable and relaxed in one's life. And the convention to be able to make code a little bit more readable is when you have a block of code, you always indent the code inside that block. So you can see here that in draw, you can see all those lines of code are slightly indented, but in setup, it's not. I could do that manually myself, space, space. But one thing that processing has is under edit, it has a nice little option here called auto format, and auto format will auto indent, clean up all of your blocks of code for you. So probably that was a little bit of an unnecessary digression, but it's something that is auto format and indentation and code commenting and something that's very meaningful and important to me in my life. And but you should not be like me. You should be a free spirit and just enjoy things and just don't worry about if like, you know, if a couple if your code looks like this, you should not have to like, you know, sit down in the corner and like breathe deeply for like 15 minutes. You know, you'll be fine. But anyway. Okay, so I went off on a really long tangent there, which someone will download this video and edit that out and send it back to me so I can upload it again without that. But until that happens, you had to sit through that. Okay, so we've done it. We now have setup. Size happens once. Draw. This stuff happens over and over again, over and over again, over and over again. Let's run our new program, our dynamic program that runs over time. We run it. We look at it. We have the exciting, amazing result of exactly what we had before. This is very sad. This is a sad moment in computer programming learning history. Fortunately, it's not going to be sad very long. In the next video, we're going to take this step further. But why is it still a static program? The reason why it's a static program is what did we say to do in draw over and over again? Exactly the same thing. Exactly the same thing. Draw the rectangle at 32180. Draw the rectangle at 32180. Draw the rectangle at 32180. It never moves. It never changes color. It never grows. It never does anything. This is our next step. If we have a program that runs over time, how do we introduce the concept of variation into this loop? So I suppose what I would suggest to you before you watch the next video is find something you made and sort of get set up and draw into your sketch. Try to type out the syntax, see if you run into any errors. Just get a sketch with set up and draw. And something I will say, if for some reason you're following along the Learning Processing book, it does something which says, take your elaborate, crazy, alien design and put it in a dynamic program. And actually what I would suggest to you, after some experience of using this book with teaching, is don't do that. I would say come up with something really simple. Make a very simple design, one circle, one rectangle, because what we're going to focus on is less about all this code and gobbledygook for drawing an elaborate pattern on the screen. We want to focus on just starting to animate a simple element, how to introduce variation into our program. It's going to be a lot easier to do that with a simple sketch and not an elaborate design. Later, you can kind of understand what it means to like start building more elaborate designs, but right now we want to focus on the sort of flow of a program. So, boy, that was a much longer video than I imagined, even though I have no idea how long it was. And I will be recording the next one as soon as I press the stop button and the start button. See, I just keep going. This is artificial that I stop and start. I think I would like them to be lots more short ones, but I don't know. I'm just doing the best I can. Thank you very much.